afternoon for those who are following us on evening time. My name is I'm the chair of the Society of Anesthesiologists in Rwanda, and I've been invited by the Society of Anesthesiologists of Uganda to share my point of view how critical care can enable achieving sustainable development goals in Uganda. I'm not an expert of Uganda. It will be just a point of view from a Rwandan neighbor country. So we'll first present on sustainable development goals, then pass through the COVID-19 paradox before giving my point of view on how critical care can be considered in the sustainable development goals. So from the history, we can see that there was a pandemic which sustained a great development, poliomyelitis. In 1931, one of the famous doctors, Eugene Farley, helped by helping poliomyelitis patients, he managed to bring this invention from Harvard University to Rochester University, where it helped a lot of patients. This is the iron, the bedside iron lung, which from which we can now have what we call the portable ventilator, which is now computerized and is helping a lot of patients. So which means the pandemic of COVID-19 should not stop us from projecting ahead how critical care can be also essential for sustainable development goals. It's just a matter of raising the awareness about the sustainable development goals. Those are international goals where the world sit, people from the world sit and say, what can we share together? How can we work so that we are all working toward common goals? So there are 17 goals, but the first one you can see is there should not be poverty, the world, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, and so forth and so on. And as you can see, for each, there is a number of targets going with it. As doctors, we must focus on the number 3, good health and well-being, and the number 4, quality education. But poverty is part of our job. Stopping poverty, zero hunger, climate change, life and land, all those goals can be found in medicine, and medicine can be found in those goals. So raising up the awareness about those goals should be our role as medical doctors or health professionals. The sustainable development goals should not be treated as a standalone project from New York. They should be fully owned by the countries, integrated in the national planning strategies, domesticated and adapted to the national context. US, American people will not act on the SDGs like Rwanda or Uganda. We need to adapt those goals toward our national context, to integrate them in our plan, into our plans, and to make it part of our life. So beyond that, over the two past years, we've been facing COVID-19. COVID-19 for most of the population in the world was catastrophic. But there is a paradox. As we saw it for the iron lung, there can be some paradox behind the COVID-19. Yes, there is deeply negative impact, but we need to see also the part of the positive transformative change we can benefit from the COVID-19. Let us start by the negative impact. Yes, there is COVID-19 is a threat to reverse progress on the global goals. It has disrupted most of our plan, starting from education. Many students stayed home for long, more than a year. Number of teachers didn't teach well, were privated with their little mean for teaching. COVID pandemic is attributed to the reversal of the SDG progress in some of the area and delayed action on many of the major transitions required to meet the 2030 goals. This pandemic has had a deeply negative impact on the health and well-being, employment, business, and income, the education and the human rights, and particularity it was damaging effect on the women and girls. Extreme poverty on the quarter of a billion is directly resulting from the pandemic. So those are some negative impacts. Let us now check on the positive transformative changes which result from the coronavirus. We can see that this challenge pushed this health system towards some changes. It is obvious healthcare workers and policymakers alike that an effective critical care surge response must be nested within the overall care delivery model. The COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted key elements of emergency preparedness. Those include having national or regional strategic reserves of PPEs, intensive care devices, consumables and pharmaceutical, as well as effective supply chain and efficient utilization of protocol. It was my first time to see some of the devices for delivering high flow oxygen, which couldn't be bought by my hospital before, but during COVID-19, it was easy for many population to share those devices. Some electronic devices for monitoring patients, those in the red zone, those in the green zone, could share data, and that was the integration of many of the electronic system for monitoring patients. Some other positive transformative changes are accommodation of surge of patient and ICU staffing model should allow for fluctuation in demand. Pre-existing ICU triage and end-of-life care principles should be established, implemented, and updated. Daily workflow process should be restructured to include remote connection with multidisciplinary healthcare workers and frequent communication with relatives. The pandemic has also demonstrated the benefit of digital transformation and the value of remote monitoring technology, such as wireless monitoring. So we can see that the pandemic has highlighted the value of pre-existing epidemiological registries and agile randomized control platform trial in generating fast and reliable data. The COVID-19 pandemic is a reminder that beside our duty to care, we are committed to improve. By meeting those challenges today, we'll be able to provide better care to the future patient. So, we can see that the COVID-19 should not stop us from being optimistic that we can achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. Yes, at some point we can say it has delayed some of the achievement, but we can also say that that challenge has helped people to think very fast that it can even accelerate our speed towards meeting the Sustainable Development Goals. Like, as you can see, how a world system, how, what we can learn from the COVID-19 pandemic to shape our future of the critical care. We become more effective in ICU triage because we know that disease can kill. A system approach to critical care crisis has been created in the countries, effective epidemiological registries, expandable ICU bed capacity, efficient supply of consumable devices and pharmaceutical, agile randomized control trials, expandable ICU staffing pool, and digital transformation. A lot of changes appeared and rapidity in innovative measures to save life. And that the healthcare system should take advantage of what happened during the pandemic to be integrating our system for efficient critical care management. Now, let us look at how critical care and SDGs can be merged to achieve the sustainable goals. These are learned from the engineers in climate. We need to first have a clear pathway. Where are we? And where do we want to go? And what do we want to achieve? So we are in critical care as specialists. We want to be part of the Sustainable Development Goals agenda so that we can all by 2030 achieve a good development of critical care. So what is my proposition is we need to have 4 steps. Definition of critical care functionality. Second step, consideration of sustainable development goals, target and target-based critical care functionality. Then step 3, selection of SDGs, key performance indicators based on application criteria. Step 4, start assessing of the SDGs, key performance indicators, numeric data, so that the output can be sustainability performance for critical care development activities. So, on the next slide, we will go through each step and see what can that step mean during our journey. So the input is awareness of sustainable development goals. Second step, we've seen the 4 steps toward the output, which is sustainability performance for critical care development activities. First of all, we've seen the awareness on SDGs. Most of our medical doctors are not aware about the SDGs. We can't claim anything by 2030 if we don't integrate our practice into the SDGs. That's where we need to integrate SDGs into our curriculum and teach our medical doctor that there is goals toward all the population of the world are working. There is goals to be achieved. So whatever we are doing, we should align it toward these goals so that year by year, we will be monitoring and evaluating the achievement. So let us see the step 1. Step 1, we can call it defining critical care. Why critical care? And where is critical care in the health system care? It must be integrated in the health system for resource-limited settings where we have mostly the primary care, vaccination, nutrition, family planning, the government will mostly care about that primary care. Then comes the emergency department and hospital-based care for acute deterioration of patients. At the top of the pyramid comes the critical care for acute life-threatening complications. So we see that many diseases can come generated from the primary care in the society when it is not well prevented, can come to the hospital, and every patient in the hospital is likely candidate to critical care. So we should be aware in each and every hospital opening to cater for critical care, because a percentage of patients in the hospital will need critical care. So critical care is part of the, should be part of all the planifications. The problem is we want to build 100 beds, 500 beds, 1,000 beds, but if you see the number of critical care beds, they are most of the time very little. And when they are there, they're just in name of bed. Are they really critical care bed? People would call it critical care or intensive care, but maybe for the, due to the lack of awareness about what is a bed, critical care bed, so we don't have sufficient of them. What is critical care? Critical care is essentially nursing care. We want to talk about this because we try to make critical care very specialized, that we are losing the essence of it. We have sub-specialized medical doctors with non-trained nurses, and we end up into frustration and disappointment. We should keep the concept from Florence Nightingale about critical care should start from the nursing care. So if we want to have stable and strong critical care, we need to consider what is the level of the nursing care, what is the level of the nurses' training that will provide a safe and sustainable critical care. What is critical care? It's medical care for people who have life-threatening injuries and illness. So among those patients, we may have some with communicable disease and others without with non-communicable disease. And the number of diseases requiring critical care is just increasing, especially now with the non-communicable disease, from the trauma up to metabolic diseases, hemorrhage, and others. So the need is real. It's becoming more specialized now, and the care we provide there is mostly oxygenotherapy, because we want to sustain and to save life, tracheostomy tube to facilitate ventilation, we need ventilators, but not only, we need catheters to be fixed, they are flexible or sometimes rigid, sometimes we need dialysis machine, which is called artificial kidney. We need nutrition support, must be part of ICU, IV, and machine too for monitoring. The most specialized goes up to arterial catheterization, central venous catheter, chest tube insertion, and more tubes are needed in the ICU now. So that's how ICU is becoming very specialized, but we need always as expert to keep it simple and think about the nurses on the bedside. If they don't understand whatever we are doing, whatever the specialization we are doing, it will end up into a chaos and a failure. So while defining the critical care, we talk about it, the double burden of disease. There is non-communicable disease, which are becoming many, and we have the communicable disease, which is due to coming caused by either will cause maternal and child mortality, malnutrition, human immunodepression, and many other causes will either cause infection or complicate it into infection. So we need to consider all those two while talking about critical care. The burden of resource-limited setting is most of the time in the resource-limited setting, deficiency in access to healthcare, emergency triage is a problem, and lack of early recognition. Most of our patients will come always late. When we talk about the sepsis bundle, most of the time we are not even able to practice to apply what is described in the books, because how many times do we receive a patient in the 24 hours of the beginning of sepsis? Most of the time, patients arrive to us after 1 week or 2 weeks, after having tried all kind of treatments, traditional treatment, when they come to us, mostly it's always too late. Triage system is most of the time not working properly, and sometimes even no bed take care of those patients. Patients are dying due to RDS, and mostly we are losing young patients and children. That shows us how the burden is devastating our countries, our communities, our countries, and our continent. So now, the question is still there. How critical care can enable achieving the Sustainable Development Goals in Uganda? Let us consider now the step two, consideration of Sustainable Development Goals target and target-based critical care functionality. Those targets, we will put them into the 4S, space, staff, and system. About the space, we all know that resource-limited countries has very few beds. This study, which was the national estimate of critical care capacity in 54 African countries, you can find it online, show that the whole continent, across the whole continent, we have only less than 150 ICU beds. And there was an average of 3.10 ICU bed and 0.97 ventilator per 100 population. The average of ICU bed was ranging between 0.53 in low-income countries, in middle-income countries 8.5, while in high-income countries we go up to 33 bed per 100,000 population. You can see this discrepancy between the two countries, in Seychelles and in the low-income countries. Less than one bed. Less than one ICU bed per 100,000 population. So many people who are in need of ICU are dying because of lack of ICU bed. For the staff, average of 35 physicians per 100 population, an average of 2.42 in total physician, non-physician, anesthetist per 100 thousand population. So that is not, if we can't count physician anesthesiologists, because they are for now the one caring for the burden of ICU, it's between 0.1 and 0.5 physician anesthesiologists in Africa. But if we put them together with another physician, because they can also help for intubation and sometimes for ventilator management in some countries, they are just 2.42. A lot of nurses, but very few which are specialized. So we are finding many nurses in ICU who are not specialized in ICU. And what do we need? We need availability of skilled medical personnel. We need availability of skilled nurse personnel And we need availability of other specialists like respiratory physiotherapists. Coming back to Florence Nightingale concept, it is time for us to think about task sharing and task shifting with the non-physician advanced practitioners. Because if you see the average of number of physicians, less than 40 per 100,000. Among them, some will become surgeons, gynecologists, pediatricians. Very few will go to anesthesia, and again, fewer of them will go up to critical care. So meaning, we might not even achieve the 0.01% of the needed physician for intensive care. So it's time to think about advanced non-physician practitioners. In other countries of the world, even in IC, in the US, you will find a lot of advanced practice providers in ICU who are highly trained nurses and non-nurses allowed to practice in ICU, working with one physician. So, this is another proposition. So when we think about equipment, supplies, and consumables, very few ventilators. The word ventilator has become popular during COVID because patients were dying and many habitants of the world thought the ventilator could save, and a lot of ventilators were provided in the world. But ventilators are just iceberg in ICU because they need a lot of brain behind to be well used, and a lot of equipment going with it to provide proper ICU care. We need monitor capacity. We have a lot of bed without monitoring capacity, critical care. We need availability of resources for the support of failing organ disease, like dialysis, central line, invasive monitors, availability of essential medication and equipment. Most ICU don't even, in many hospitals, they don't have any proper chain of supply. They have to get the supply either from the ward or from theater. So it makes ICU always poor and begging. What about the system? Very few ICU has an academic activities, teaching. And we all know that it is through teaching where we sustain an improvement of practice. Integration with ICU outreach service. The good work should be to prevent patients to arrive to ICU rather than waiting in ICU. Those very sick patients arriving in ICU already pretty dead. Availability to scale up service in response to a natural or human-made disaster or pandemic outbreak. An example is my hospital. We couldn't manage to receive COVID patient in our hospital because we were not prepared for it. Lucky enough, the government could manage to open another ICU. Opening another ICU means with poorly trained nurses, poorly trained doctors to start up a new ICU for a disaster. Poor infection prevention control, the role in acting as a referral service for the hospital, the community, and the countries. Most ICU are just small and just there for the hospital. When it comes from transfer or referral from other places, capacity are not enough to share those equipment. There is no QI activities or research. Poorly functioning early critical care services. We have sometimes some ambulances working, but if you enter into an ambulance which we send to bring patients to us, doesn't meet any standard. An ambulance should be a moving ICU bed with all the need for an ICU bed moving from one hospital to another one. But most of our ambulances don't meet that. continuity of care. Some patients are already in good condition, they've passed for the CAP, they can be transferred to step down. Because of lack of those skills into the ward or out of the hospital, they have to stay in the ICU or sometimes be discharged at risk. Data management to ensure to measure the outcome, not well followed up. The policy and leadership support. Most leaders think ICU is just expensive and less likely of survival until one of the member is hospitalized. Then we receive maybe even night calls all the times for saving those lives. So it's our job to raise up the voice and make sure our policymakers understand that ICU save life. We can lose 30% of our patients, but we save 70%. And those 70% are patients who came bleeding, came in coma, and are going back home and become future doctors to treat life of others. So it is our role. So what are the barriers to delivery, to deliver quality critical care in those settings? We have lack of epidemiological data. Context-specific evidence for medical decision-making. Deficiency in health system organization and resources, institutional of the obstacle to implementation of life-saving intervention. Now, let us see the step three, which is selection of KPI based on application criteria. So we need key performance indicator from the SDGs to help us applying our critical care development. So what are those will be framed as potential solution and opportunity for innovation in ICU. So we'll have clinical guideline, health care system strengthening, education, research capacity, and IC organization. Those, if I'm not dictating key performance indicators, it is just like a model which we can change, we can adapt to start having indicators which we know year after year, those will be our indicators. We'll be following those indicators to know how far, where are we coming from, where we are now, and where are we going, so that in 2025 we can have a mid-term evaluation of those indicators before 2030 to see if we've achieved something. Guideline. As we know, in resource-limited countries, we are not driving research to generate our clinical guidelines. So we have to adapt. That's the solution I propose. Adapt existing guideline to bring a feasible, effective, and safe practice to the ICU. So that from the one we adapt from other countries, we can check them through research and quality improvement and see if it works, we improve them. If it doesn't work, we change them. But we need at least to have a baseline of clinical guidelines in each and every ICU. Secondly, we need to strengthen the healthcare system so that decision makers must accept that high quality, equitable intensive care services are necessary to achieve. This is our role, to raise up the voice until our policymaker understand that this is achievable. There is a lot of examples where policymakers, when they need ICU, will go in another country and get better care. So if this is evident, why can't we achieve? Why can't we advocate for achievable, high quality, equitable intensive care service in our country? The third one is education and capacity building. As we know, in most of our curricula in medical school, there is not the ICU training. Maybe 2-3 chapters which we just pass through and go. We are very busy to produce GPs who will do C-section or whatever, but without knowledge in critical care. In our postgraduate education, very few students spend their time in ICU. And we even know they are passing, because we know they're not practice ICU, we just take them as to clerk our patient, but we don't spend time to teach them those skills, knowing they will practice them. The critical care pathway even is not well framed, and there is limits to limited access to continuing medical education. So this shows the need to invest in education and capacity building for ICU. It is very costly to train a full intensivist, from either physician or from anesthesiologist, but it can be less costly to train nurse intensivist. So if we can have a pyramid with a large foundation of nurses at the middle, other non-physician, non-nurses, critical care trained, and on the top of the pyramid, well-trained intensivist physician, if he's alone, he'll be less called to be on duty. It's because he work with 5 other people, we can do a lot before he arrive. But if we don't train others, the one and only intensivist we have will be totally exhausted before 6 months, and we lose him. Research. We need to prevent, or we need also to define clear clinical guidelines. This can't be possible without clear epidemiology of disease, diagnosis tool, therapeutic and implementation of critical care resources, and again, reevaluate and readapt. So this is the role of research in ICU. It is essential because it will help us to improve and to achieve a lot. IC organization. There is disparity in the organization of ICU, even in the name of ICU. For some, all critical care services are ICU. For some, ICU can go up to HDU. For some other, ICU is different from HDU. That shows why we have discrepancy in even the description of number across many countries. I found most of the time when I read the paper on number of critical care beds in ICU, some people will put only intensive care beds. Some people will do intensive care plus HDU. Some people will say, okay, because we say plus HDU, we can also add emergency beds. So then you end up with sometimes the double or even 4 times the number of beds we know. A recent paper published is talking about 20 beds, 27 beds in Rwanda. The other one was talking about 63 beds in Rwanda. So depending, so if we don't harmonize our organization and the nomination of what we call ICU, what we call critical care services, we'll end up with discrepancy in number of beds, and our language for advocacy will be very misunderstood. So I propose this one from the WHO, the World Federation of Society of Intensive Care, for intensive and critical care medicine, which gives frame of 3 levels. Level 1 is capable of providing oxygen, non-invasive monitoring, and more intensive nurse care than regular ward. So this is something we call HDU, or sometimes in some literature in French they call the chocage, but it is also level 1. Level 2 is which have short-term ability of providing intensive care monitoring, invasive monitoring, and basic life support. Then level 3, capable of providing the full spectrum of monitoring and life support technology, serving as regional resources for the care of critically ill patients, and also playing an active role in research and education. This is what most of the time we call ICU, but we need to consider different levels, and all should be called ICU, so that we will know what we are counting. If such research can be done, redone again, maybe we can know how many beds do we have in our countries and in our continent, on our continent. So now the step 4, after fixing the indicators on clinical guidelines, on strengthening healthcare system, on education and capacity building, on research, and finally on ICU organization. Now we need to assess those KPI. Are we achieving them? The numeric data. So what shall we do? It will be development of common definition for intensive care that we've discussed, and intensive care to create a universal ICU organization framework, development of education program for capacity building of healthcare professional working in resource limited settings, global prioritization of epidemiological and clinical research in resource limited settings to conduct timely and ethical study in response to emerging threats, adaptation of international guidelines to promote implementation of evidence-based care, strengthening health system that integrate those intervention. So we need to put number of this. If we say developing common definition of critical care, then we can say how many of level 1 do we need? How many of level 2 do we need? How many of level 3 do we need? Where do we need it? So that when we propose something to the government, it is understandable and we can make the journey together to be an achievable plan. I will give you an example. Like recently in Rwanda, we wanted to talk to the government about how many anesthesiologists do we need for Rwanda to make Rwanda safe. So we came up with the hub and spoke model, which we call 1+7/2, where the hub will be a provincial hospital, the spoke will be a district hospital. District hospital will be the functional level. Then we consider that each district hospital should have one physician. By 2030, we'll have one physician anesthesiologist, 7 non-physician anesthesia provider over 2 operating theater. So if this one is well taught, then it passes through the government, we shall start working together and invest to achieve that. Then we will have the referral hospital or the hub will be 4 times the spoke. Then we'll have the referral hospital 10 times the spoke. Then a teaching hospital, which can be even 10, so the referral will be 7 times and the teaching hospital will be 10 times. So by putting those numbers together, because the policymakers are very interested in the district hospital. If you make the functional unit, the district hospital, safe, then the investment of the government will follow, because the Ministry of Health understand more the language of primary care up to the district hospitals. It is less costly and it is easy to achieve, so that the referral hospital will be consequences of this investment. So we came up with those numbers. If we work toward this, we will end up with 1,000 NPAs in Rwanda and 150 physician anesthesiologists. So this is not ideal for now, but it is something which can impact policymakers and start the journey together. We can always make a midterm revision, midterm evaluation to come up with another solution. But at least we need numerical data which will guide all the investment toward SDGs. So if such exercise can be done also for critical care, with clear definition, where in Uganda do we need level one? And what is the definition of level one? How many beds do we need in an hospital, level one ICU? How many ventilators? Apart from those who are on bedside, how many should be kept aside for replacement, for transport? How many nurses? At which level? Master's level? Bachelor level? How many respiratory therapists? How many anesthesia providers? How many intensivists? If we integrate those numbers of critical care into the national surgery, anesthesia, and obstetric plan, that can work together, because that's what the government care about more than other languages. So, to summarize myself, my suggestion is not like having all the four steps as I'm presenting it, but at least we need to, first of all, raise up awareness about the SDGs. People should know those SDGs and their target, so that identified what influences critical care and what critical care is influencing. Define steps through which we can go. By definition of critical care, what do we call critical care? Functionalities. Consideration of SDGs target and target-based critical care functionalities. Define the KPIs. So we come up with activities we would like to achieve while building our critical care. How many are critical care level one, level two, level three, and the numbers and the frame in the countries to make the country safe, so that we can have this need to be worked up with the public health specialist, sustainability impact score assessment framework, to see at each level of output the sustainability performance for critical care development activities. So we can see, as we have annual conference, we can say, last year we were here, this year we've achieved this, next year we plan to achieve this. Until 2025, during midterm, we need to see where we are. Then 2030, we cannot maybe achieve everything, but at least if we can achieve 50 to 70% of the target we fixed together, that would be a great achievement. Raising up awareness on sustainable development goals. It is our role. This is not only for politicians. All clinicians should be integrated into these SDGs, so that work toward achieving the next goal, while also considering that COVID is not only impacting negatively, but there is some positive transformative change which can help us achieving Sustainable Development Goals. Thanks very much. Mwebalinyo.